Hello friends, in the sequence of ENT lectures or virtual classes, we'll deal with a new topic today. That will be tinnitus. Tinnitus is a long topic or lengthy topic. In order to cover this this topic, we'll probably have two classes. The number one will deal with the location of the tinnitus, definition segment, and what kind of pathologies are responsible for the generation of this tinnitus. So, and in the second class, probably we'll go through the diagnostic part and the treatment part. So this will be the tinnitus lecture one or class one, and the next will be the lecture one or class two of the tinnitus. My name is Dr. Atul Bharadwaj, and I am assistant professor of ENT or Shalaki Tantra. Shalaki Tantra is a word used in Indian system of medicine. I'm a doctor of Indian system of medicine, and we used to have regular classes of ENT. And today's topic will be tinnitus. So we will start with the introductory part of the tinnitus. So let me expand it and then we will start. Okay. So today's class topic will be tinnitus or tinnitus, whatever you want to call it. So tinnitus is a hearing of abnormal sounds which are supposed to be generated in patient's head. So routinely also every one of us has appreciated some kind of or appreciated or we have observed or experienced some kind of a sound in our ear also, but and not every sound is a pathological sound. Many a times this temporomandibular joint clicking, as well as firing of the neurons around the middle ear or the internal ear. And apart from that, there is a contraction of the levator villi palatini or tensor villi palatini, self-pharyngopharyngeus, and other para-auditory muscles. Para-auditory muscles are the muscles which are present around the temporal bone. So these firing or contraction behavior of these membranes can lead to a usual sound, which is not a pathological sound. These sounds are called as somato sounds. Somato is body, and sounds are the regular sounds which are produced by various structures surrounding the temporal bone, middle ear, internal ear, and per se. So tinnitus is a lengthy topic. So we have to have the pathological segment also, how the brain appreciates even a normal sound into an abnormal sound, how come these firing of the neuron can produce a sound in the internal ear and beyond internal ear or retrocochlear part of the conduction mechanism also. So this is a very introductory segment, and the word tinnitus has extracted from the etymology lies in the Latin language, which the word is tinnire and the meaning is to ring. So not every patient it is one of the most common complaint in case of a ENT OPD. So if you go through the common presentations in the ENT OPD, these will be the pain in the ear. That will be that pain in the ear is I think the most common. Then the hearing loss is very, very common. Discharges, and then probably this hearing of abnormal sounds or tinnitus will appear. So it's one of the most disturbing also, because at the time of sleep, when the surround disturbing sound or suppressive or compressive sound disappears, then the sound which is originating in the head or the patient supposed into the ear also enhances, augments or fosters, and which leads to a deep distress or anxiety state in the patient. And many of the patient even claim that they have got some sinusitis disorder, and which needs investigation. But in majority of the cases, counseling is good enough. You have to do a good endoscopy of the canal, look at the middle ear, and check the hearing state of the patient. You can do an audiogram as well, peritone audiogram as well. And in some cases, when the pathology and the features warrants, we can also go for imaging like a MRI or CT scan, depending upon the nature of diagnosis the doctor is going to make. So not every case of tinnitus needs extensive investigations and extensive treatment. Most of the cases are in the patient in which a patient is apprehensive that he is having some kind of a tumor in his head, and any kind of occult or hidden pathology is having, which is bound to distress him time and again. But most of the time, if you do basics proper, you do an endoscopy and a routine examination well, then the patient can be counseled beforehand that there is no need of much of a treatment in his case. And the treatment, most of the cases respond well to the counseling part of the treatment. So this about the traditional part, this hearing of the abnormal sound, which is called tinnitus or tinnitus, is extensively discussed in Ayurvedic literature. Ayurvedic word is used for Indian system of medicine. Indian system of medicine or Ayurveda, the most of the literature written is between 1 AD and 8th AD, and the classical written textual or textual material is having numerous references about this hearing of abnormal sound. So this is not a new pathology, and most of the aspect of this hearing and abnormal hearing part also is discussed in this Indian system of medicine literature. So we'll talk about that in another class. This is for the modern counterpart or the Western side, the Western part of the medicine of the disease. Sorry. So the patient can appreciate. First of point I will like to make here is not every patient who is visiting for a hearing of abnormal sound in the ear is having some kind of a sinusitis. Most of the cases are innocuous and self-limiting, need not much of an investigation or treatment as such, and will settle down in most of the cases without even a treatment, and counseling is good enough for them. But patient may complain different type of sounds like a ringing, hissing, roaring, or a whistling, swishing, buzzing, and chirping. But this actually do not help much in localizing the origin of the sound, whether the sound is coming from the canal or the tympanic membrane or the middle ear or the internal ear is not suggested by the quality of the sound which is the patient is claiming. So you can't say that buzzing sound is coming from the internal ear and the whistling is coming from the middle ear. So this kind of a segregation or classification is of no use, and various studies, audiological studies, has proved that a bimodal experimentation, bimodal in the sense is neither the quality of the sound is much of a helpful in localizing the site of the disease or the origin of the tinnitus, neither the intensity of the sound is suggestive of the pathology itself. So neither the intensity which is the patient is claiming that this is a very very loud sound out, I cannot sleep. Most of the cases in the audiometric value, when we gave a comparison to that, will be less than about 14 or 15 decibel or 20 decibel. So the sound the patient is claiming is not worth to consider, is worth to consider in to certain extent, but it cannot certainly suggest what kind of a organ involvement in the internal ear or beyond internal ear or retrocochlear or central nervous system is involved, because most of the in majority of the degenerative condition, whole of the conduction mechanism is by and large is sluggish in the senses. Degenerative changes happens to be throughout the internal ear, middle ear, and beyond the internal ear as well. So the majority of the patient, if the treatment or counseling is not done, it will lead to a grave amount of anxiety and distress to the patient also. So the counseling part is also very important, and every physician newly venturing ENT physician want to have a good command on this tinnitus, then should have some basic knowledge of the counseling aspect of the tinnitus also, because majority will not need treatment. So these are some audiological causes. So we already stated that we have got two types of sounds: para-auditory sounds and auditory sounds. Auditory are which are responsible the sound which are originated in the hearing apparatus, like the internal ear, middle ear conduction mechanism, meliocinctus, tapes, and the two muscles also. Para-auditory tinnitus is a tinnitus which happens to be or originated in the structures which are around the middle ear, the internal ear, like the blood vessels, the tendons, the muscles, and even some pathologies like AVMs and the vascular hams also. So these are some common clinical pictures which are associated with a patient of tinnitus. Tinnitus, again, I will emphasize, is a hearing of an abnormal sound which is supposed to be generated in patient's head. So these are some common coexistential conditions which are present in case of a tinnitus. So a majority of them can have a hearing loss, some can have a impaction of the wax, which is called a cerumen accumulation or occlusion, can have a patulous is a loose tympanic membrane. Normally the Eustachian tube. Eustachian tube is a dynamic structure, and we have got a different, totally different lecture in which we have catered great amount of length regarding this Eustachian tube, the anatomy, the structure which is connects, and surrounding structure which are present along with this Eustachian tube. So Eustachian tube is a dynamic structure, and most of the time it is closed. It opens while swallowing, deglutition, and yawning, etc. So abnormally blockage of the Eustachian tube and abnormally open, that is called as patulous Eustachian tube. Patulous. The word used is patulous. Patulous word. So patulous or a overly competent or a overly open, you can say, Eustachian tube can also lead to some kind of a hearing of abnormal sound. Next is a otitis media. Otitis media, we have already discussed, is an inflammatory sequence of the middle ear, in which whether there is a sterile collection, then it will be called a secretory otitis media. It happens to be with a inflammatory discharge or bacterial appearance, then it is called as acute otitis media. And when the acute otitis media settles down with a permanent perforation, that is called as CSOM is chronic suppurative otitis media, which is again of two type, unsafe and safe type. So we have already gone in detail, deep depth about this unsafe and safe type. The safe word is used only when there is absence of cholesteatoma. So we need not to go again on the cholesteatoma topic. We'll continue with this present topic of tinnitus. So exposure is of the loud noise, that is called as acoustic trauma, or NIHL. NIHL is nothing but what is the word used in case of acoustic trauma because of high intensity sound, that is NIHL. NIHL is noise induced. NIHL word is used for noise. NIHL is noise induced hearing loss. Induced hearing loss. So NIHL can also lead to a PTS or a TTS, a permanent threshold shift or a temporary threshold shift, or even certain permanent changes in the cochlea, basilar membrane, and the firing system of the neurons. So this exposure to the loud noise or noise induced hearing loss can also lead to post-traumatic this tinnitus. There are various ototoxic drugs also. We have gone through also this segment also, like the loop diuretic, the antibiotics, the NSAIDs property, the chloroquine class, and various various anti-metabolite drugs also can lead to certain changes in the basilar membrane, stiffening of the basilar membrane, fracturing of the hair cilia, and chemical changes also, which can cause a hearing of abnormal sounds along with a hearing loss. So Simultaneously, the patient can present with a cochleotoxic properties as well as the vestibulotoxic properties. The vestibulotoxic properties will lead to the balance problem, because ear is the primary organ of balance, and the hearing is a secondary function. The the ototoxic drugs can cause a balance disorder as well as the hearing disorder as well. And apart from that, having a hearing of abnormal sound as well. Otosclerosis is an excessive hyalinization of the middle ear tympanic membrane, between the layer of the tympanic membrane. Then it is called as meningosclerosis. The presence of hyalinization or new bone formation is called as otosclerosis. And there are frequent sites of this disorder as well. It can lead to conductive hearing loss in majority of the cases, but if the endotoxin is present in the middle ear, in the internal ear also, then it can also cause a mixed hearing loss. Meniere's disease is a well appreciated disorder. You can say a syndromic appearance in ENT practice, and Meniere's by the name of the scientist which has documented the disease, Prosperous Meniere's, the disease lies, and it's a very common, it's not a rare disorder, and you can encounter that disorder and in a busy ENT practice routinely, every day almost. So this is, what is this Meniere's disease? This is episodic tinnitus with a hearing loss and a dizziness, a whirling. So the patient have some kind of a restricted mobility, restricted in an acute phase, the patient cannot even have some kind of a mobility also. So absolutely bedridden is the patient. So this is a triad of a hearing loss, a disequilibrium or dizziness, or a vertigo, a peripheral vertigo, and some books also add oral fullness or a heaviness of the ear also. So these are some common condition. Apart from that, a tumor of the of the eighth nerve. What is eighth nerve? Eighth nerve is vestibulocochlear nerve, also called a statoacoustic nerve, with the eighth cranial nerve. And the tumor of this of this eighth nerve can lead to expansile pathology, a space occupying pathology, also called as neurofibromatosis type 2. So we have got neurofibromatosis type 1, which is nothing but a systemic disorder, which is called as Von Reckling-Huysens disease, whereas this Von Reckling-Huysens disease is a systemic disorder in which there is a neuroma formation on the whole body, and the NF2 is reserved only for acoustic neuroma. So it's a most common neuroma of any cranial nerve, you can say. So it can also lead to some kind of a tinnitus in various patients, depending upon the size of the tumor itself. So we have got these common conditions. One is from the canal, you can see, one of the eustachian tube, one is the middle ear, one is internal ear changes is the NIHL, ototoxic again internal ear, otosclerosis is middle ear plus internal ear, Meniere's is again internal ear, acoustic neuroma is the NF2, neurofibromatosis, or a Schwann sheath tumor, you can say, schwannoma of the peripheral nervous system. It's a tumor of the neural sheath of eighth cranial nerve. So these are some audiological causes. So again, as far as the literature is concerned, two type of classification. Of the tinnitus is on the clinical biased, and there is a subjective and objective tinnitus. You can give a comparison between subjective is when only the patient perceives this tinnitus, and this is by far the most common type of tinnitus in which only the patient can perceive and the physician cannot perceive the sound. But there are some especially we have got a vascular tinnitus, especially of carotid artery roots and the high intensity sound of the arterial system around the internal ear, which can be appreciated by the use of a stethoscope in the neck region, in the common carotid artery or the internal carotid artery system, and the physician can appreciate them with a stethoscope. These are called as objective tinnitus, or the tinnitus in both of the patient and the physician can appreciate the sound. So we will go through the para-auditory structures and the carotid artery and the jugular vein structure, which are responsible for abnormal sound, which are called as carotid artery bruits and venous hums in the next class, and probably will take the treatment part also in the next discussion or the next lecture. Thank you for watching the video. Please subscribe the channel also. Thank you very much.